welcome to the Jazz Transcription Clinic Podcast Live. This will alternate the usual interview podcast, which is released every first day of every month. And in the middle of the month, on the 15th, I will release a live episode where I actually am going to transcribe a track for about 1 hour. So if I don't finish the whole transcription, maybe I will finish it in the next episode or on my own. Today I would like to start transcribing a track that I loved since the first time I heard it, and I have already transcribed it years and years ago, but I would like to start with this one so you can see and I can show you my personal process in transcribing. Today I will transcribe Michael Brecker track called The Cost of Living. It is a composition written by the great Don Grolnick, who's also playing the piano, I think, on this track, if I remember well. And it is included in the first album that Michael Brecker recorded on his name. The band is unbelievable, of course. There is Jack DeJohnette on drums, Charlie Hayden on bass, Kenny Kirkland playing piano, and Pat Metheny playing guitar. So A Cost of Living is a beautiful ballad, and it's in concert C minor, so it becomes D minor for saxophone. And as you can see, I have prepared a score on Sibelius because I'll like to write it down as soon as I get the notes. So let's start, and I will talk about the process ongoing. So first thing is there are four bars introduction by the rhythm section. So what I would like to do is to highlight the fact that the first four bars are empty, and then the saxophone starts here in bar five. And let's listen how the saxophone starts. What I like to do when I transcribe, I like to get one phrase. Sometimes it's not possible, of course, if the phrase is extremely long or if there are too many notes and I can't catch all of them. So in that case, I will have to cut the phrase in bits and pieces. But in this case, I think it's pretty easy to learn the first phrase. The first thing I do is try to sing back. Da, 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 da. I have no idea yet what those notes are. Well, actually, I'm a liar. I have a great idea of what the notes are, but let's pretend I don't have any idea. So I will try to sing back. Da, da, da. And then I can start searching for the note. So this would be my first note. Do, 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 do. And I can start recollect all my theory knowledge and all the lessons that I got when I was a kid on what is that sound? Do, 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 do. On a minor key, that sounds pretty much like an ascending melodic minor scale of D minor. So I got the notes, And then the most important part, of course, is the rhythm. And the rhythm is do, ba, 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 dee, da. So all the notes are anticipated, except for the last two, which both are anticipated. So it will become 3, 4. Right? I can try to play with Michael. Right. So I got the notes. I can start writing the notes. I will use the piano for that. And in this bar here, I have to write. And of course, on the piano, I have to write in concert. So the first note will be a concert chi, so A on tenor. And Sibelius is set to write already in tenor. And then there is a minim in total for the next note. So the B natural will be a minim, but I won't write a minim. It will look very wrong. So the right way to write it is write the B natural and then tied to another dotted crotchet. And then I have the C sharp, which is anticipated, as I said, another dotted crotchets. And then I have the D tied. Da, 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 da. And then the last note is dee-dum, dee-da. Okay, now let's say it's a whole note. But this is very important, guys. When you transcribe, mind note durations. That's really important. It's a critical factor. So I just put a whole note, but I have the feeling that that note is a bit longer, so we can simply count the note. 1, 2, 3, 4. All right. So this note, it is extended by at least 2 beats. In the next bar, right? And now it should look pretty accurate, the first phrase. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, off. Right, so he plays a little fade here, but these are the things that I want to remember once I play this thing. So if I play, I will go. And make sure that I fade. In about here in the last part of that note. Okay, next one. Five notes, right? Dee, da, da. Da, da. So I got the notes. The rhythm is pretty easy again. Dee, da, da. the D on the tenor, the D will be on the downbeat, right? So this is a rest of a Dr. Crotchet's di-da-da. So 1, 2, 3, 4, di-da-da. So it's the end of the 4. And it would be 2 semiquavers. Da-da, do, do, do. And then these are all whole notes. Now, same thing as before. Let's check the duration. So same thing. So this is tied to a minute. Is that? I know you know. So that is exactly the first phrase, an octave above, right? So I can simply copy and paste. There is also this note. Da bo do de do. Di-da-da. Right? Da. And now it changes. So we need to transcribe this. Do do da do do da bo do da do do. So you can listen back to how many times you need until you can sing it. When you sing it, you can play it. Da bo do da bo do. And don't be shy. You can't be worse than me at singing. Da do do da do. Right, so you can try different notes, you can try until you get that sound that you have in your head. Da do do de. So that's the same note. And then there is a major seven descending interval. Da do da do. Very difficult even to sing. Right? Let's grab the rhythm. Now, it's not quaver and semi-quavers, because otherwise it would sound da-da-da. It's a little bit more relaxed and wide, so da-da-da, da-da-da. So it's probably all semiquavers, right? Yes, all semiquavers. Da, so this will be a crotchet, da, tied to semiquavers. Da. Da do do da do da do do da do. I guess this is a quaver. Da do do. This probably is. Da, da. When in doubt, I always put a whole note and then I fix it later, on the last note of a phrase. Okay, close. It's not a... This is probably more like this, right? You have to be accurate. Great. So this is probably, we can call it a bridge after two A's. So I would put a double bar here just because I want to be formally accurate as well. Not only the rhythm and the notes. So we can try to go back from the start and double check. Happy with this result. Of course, I can enjoy playing just these first 16 bars with Brecker, but before I go deeper into the details of his playing, I just want to have some more, at least the whole head, and then I can try to identify all the nuances. Next phrase. Okay. Da da di da da di da 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 di da. You might be induced to think that note is da da da, but if you listen carefully, da da da, that's pretty chromatic, isn't it? Instead of. Da da da. Now, again, you can recollect your theory knowledge, and if you have linked your theory to a specific sound, which is what we all should do, so you can recognize that that is like a Napolitanian sixth, so-called in the classical music. we can call it triton substitution. That E flat has a very, very juicy sound, and that's the sound of the Napolitanian sixth, right? We are heading towards the five, A7, and we hit E flat. That specific color, that specific sounds, that once you learn it, once you learn the sound of that dual, every time you hear it, you know what it is, right? So I have no doubt that well, there is also a major triad, right? Pretty sure the notes are this. Let's check the rhythm. Right. So, of course, there is a pickup here, the first two notes. Pick up, so we need to put quaver rest, daughter crotchet rest, and then two semi quavers. So first note. B flat, I guess we can write this way. Right, because it's not really rushed, it's not quaver and two semi quavers, or it is. No, I think it's more relaxed like this. And here we write di-da-do. Oh, I'm not writing. Di-da-do. And I think maybe crotchet triplet. I will verify later. Nope. Crotchet triplet. I don't know if he's repeating the G or not. Oh, where have I gone? Probably rewrite this. I'm not happy with the rhythm. You know, I want to be accurate. So I would I would rather write to. Da, this is da, 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 da. Yeah, I like it better this way. Da-da-dee. And this one is actually dotted, and yeah, let's check the last note. Oh, basically it's a dotted crotchet. What do you think? I can't hear. Probably he's giving us such a soft tonguing. I would do that. There is, I can't hear the tonguing there. And then there is this gorgeous phrase that I love. This is almost impossible for me to sing it, right? Da, 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 da. That's it. That's like a minor triad, right? That's the sound of a minor triad. Now, if you are not sure, I mean, you can become really precise with the YouTube player and just stop whenever you need it. Or, as you probably know, you can go here into settings and set to 75% if you need it, and then right, so that would be that line, 75%. Right, I got it. Beautiful line. So it's right. Rhythm. So it's all semiquavers starting on the end of beat 3. Right, and remember, when in doubt, put a whole note. I'm back to normal speed. Da, 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 da. Isn't it similar to what we just transcribed before? No. It's still a major triad, but it's a different one. That's F sharp major triad, which means that on the dominant chord, here we are on a dominant or on a diminished chord, right? Those are the notes. So this note here is a dotted crotchet. And I guess we can write similar to what we did before. Triplet. Nope, that's I put the wrong. Right. Okay, I didn't remember well, so I have to rewrite this because, as you heard, it's much, much faster. So this time I will write da and then semiquavers. Now it reflects. So this is a minim, and should be all quavers. Right, let's go back to listen to. Beautiful. So there is also a rallentando there. And here it goes to A flat. And I would put a double bar because this is the end of this part, and I can already write it down like a ral here, right? And take the line of the ral so I remember. Right. So isn't it very similar to this line, right? But this time the notes are significantly different from here. Not significantly, just this one is C natural, but instead of stopping on F it goes above, and I think it reaches A flat. Let's have a listen. several. Right, so I can actually take this first two bar, so I don't have to write it down, and I fix this note into C natural. So that note would be. Ooh. I'm wrong. Oh, I'm right. Sorry, I got confused. Right. So this requires, you know, da 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 di da da da, requires different level of expertise. On the tenor saxophone, you have to reach G and A flat on the altissimo fingering. My preference, and this is strictly for saxophone players and tenor saxophone players, my preference in terms of fingering for the G is the top F above the B, top F, and the side B flat. And then my preference for the A flat is B, G, F, and side C. This is how I do it. So I have to write it down. Da, 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 da. So we keep going with dotted crotchet. Well, that's not a dotted crotchet. And this is all right. This should be it. Let me verify the last note duration. Okay, so the last note duration is basically, there is I would say not a crotchet, right? And then the next beat. Take these notes, even though they are not the same, but I can save some time here and put those notes. Remember, when you do it on Sibelius, you have to make sure that you have the right starting note, and the notes, da, 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 da. This is flat, da, 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 da. You can hear that there is a grace note there, so you can already write it down. But you can add all the nuances later. It's very clear that there is a grace note here. Let's keep going, because we are close to the end of the okay, 39 is where this thing happens again. So I guess we can take this one. Let's take this whole phrase. And as I said before, make sure that you create the right. So this will be okay, and then this I say quavis paste. Oops, what did I do wrong? Here, I have to paste it here. Oh, I take the quaver, that's why. I took the quaver as well. All right, let's see how this phrase goes. One, two, three. Okay, so this bit is not happening. And let's put a whole note just for now. And one, two, three. Now, this is becoming difficult. If you want to be accurate, and you have to be accurate, you have to play exactly what Michael Brecker plays. Now, my methodology here is to try to understand what, so he starts on C sharp. He goes up, I guess, chromatically and down. So we need to check what is the highest note that he reaches, and most importantly, what is the beat where he lands back on C sharp. So we are going to try to catch those two things. I guess it's the end of the four, right? Where he goes back. Yeah, it's the end of the four. So we know that he will do something and we'll land on the end of the four. Now, let's catch the highest note that it reaches in that little thing. I hear this as the highest note. High E and it goes up chromatically. Sorry guys, I just found a mistake. You know, when I played it again, I didn't realize I put the wrong note there, but that's the right note. So I guess we can transform this into a minim, and then we will have to fit like probably what I would do is something like that. Tied into a triplet. And then I can land on my C sharp on the last quaver, which is, we spotted this. right? So I think this can be pretty accurate. I would change the name of that note. Is better readable in this way. And then holds this note for, we don't know, so what we do, we put a whole note when in doubt. And this time we have been pretty lucky because he actually played a whole. This note is probably more like this. Let's listen again. Love that as well. I'm still not convinced on this one. I think what I wrote is a little bit too loose. It's the very last moment, so I think how do I write it? No, I think it's pretty right. Yeah, it's pretty right. So this is a quaver. Okay, this sounds right to me. Now, next phrase. This is the same here. Da, da, da. Right? This one. Da, da, da. How beautiful is that little slide. So this is what I would spend a few hours on trying to get that thing. But let's just write the notes for now. So da do di. This sounds like a crotchet triplet, right? Yeah, I would write it as a crotchet triplet. So that first note is da. I prefer G sharp. Again, major arpeggio. If you know the sounds of major arpeggios, you will get a lot of help. Okay. I think something like this. And then does it again, isn't it? Probably I don't know. Let's put the real and this is the last note. Let's try to fill in. After the two, so I would put it here. And we can write glissando, but we can also try to... We can also try to be a little bit more specific, right? And write, for example, something like this. Like something like that. Of course, stupid Sibelius doesn't want to put G sharp because we are in C minor. So, let's have a listen. I would write that like this, probably. And I would put a slur here and probably a little like this. So I know that this is probably not even tongue, he's just does it with his bottom lip. You know, he bends the note, so we can make probably a little like this. Like this. Something like this. Just, you know, use anything you like that you can remember what is the sound of that. Right, and it does it again here. Oh, sorry, I was there. I think there. Something like that. Let me check. Not quite. This is I would probably go with another G tied to minim, probably something like that. Even if I transcribe is not 100% precise. You cannot be 100% precise. You have to learn the sound of it. You know, all these things are so difficult to write. And even if you write it, you cannot be 100% precise. It will look so weird if we write exactly what it does. Great bass solo, great Charlie Hayden bass solo, which I would like to transcribe as well. But I'm happy. Let's just have a re-listen to it, the whole thing. Okay, so here is the end of the head, the end of the form, right? Now, let's listen with the transcription from the top of the track, right? And maybe I can play. I can play with it, and then we'll finish, right? First four bars. One, two, three. Are there. I still have not 100% happy with this one. Probably has to be written like this, like if this is splitted in two and so the first one is definitely here, and then we have semi-demi quavers in triplets. Probably this is the best way to write it. And then also here there is a little bit of inaccuracies with those those coops on the A. But I'm pretty happy with all the rest. Now this is, guys, this is just the notes and the rhythm. Now the whole work that it takes me is to sound what it does. Like, I've noticed, for example, that in this challenging part where it goes up to altissimo A flat, he took a breath here after the C natural, and I didn't. So I struggle a little bit. Or he took a breath. After the D, he breathes. And that's so important, guys, for you to understand that we need to play exactly what we hear. So if we hear a breath here, it's better if we do it. And that will help you a lot in hitting those two altissimo notes. So you can put a breath mark there, or whatever sign you think is appropriate. Guys, I don't know how to put a breath mark on Sibelius. Maybe you can chuck in the comments. I would do this, probably, and then try to move it. Oh, I can't move it. So no, that's not the right thing. Probably in lines. Let me see whether there is a breath mark. Oh no, I don't know. I will investigate. So it's not in lines. Is it in the expressions of Sibelius? Maybe in the expression. If I go to text and I go here, let me see whether I have a breath mark. No tails ornaments, a special. Oh, I don't know how to put a breath mark. That's interesting. I can find in the ribbon breath mark. No, I will do my research. Okay, but this is the degree of details that you want to get. So I will put also this transcription in on my website and in the description of the podcast. And I have to go now, but I'm very happy to have spent the last hour in Michael Brecker's company and your company as well. So stay tuned for more episodes. This will alternate to the interviews podcast. And of course, as usual, let me know if you like it. Let me know if you would like me to transcribe something in particular, and leave a comment if you want, and some suggestions if you know how to improve this podcast. Thank you. Thank you to everyone. See you next time. Bye.